Greetings to all of you, my dear students. So now we'll get into the second session of opioid analgesics and antagonists. So coming to the pharmacokinetics, they are well absorbed orally. So they also can be given rectally in the form of suppositories like morphine and hydromorphone, and also through nasal and buccal mucosal preparations, that is buprenorphine can be given. And to avoid the high first-pass metabolism, nasal insufflations of opioids can be given to achieve the therapeutic blood levels. Then other routes of opioid administration are oral mucosa via lozenges, and then transdermal patches of fentanyl to avoid extensive first-pass metabolism. So you can get the question on the various routes of administration of opioid analgesics for both PGs and UGs. It is a very, very important question. Then controlled release tablets. So to avoid the first-pass metabolism and also to produce long-lasting analgesia, and other preferred routes are IV, IM, and subcutaneous. And also intrathecal administration for producing very effective analgesia, avoiding undesirable respiratory depressant effects. And also recently, novel method is iontophoretic transdermal system has been introduced, allowing needle-free delivery of fentanyl patch for patient control analgesia. Then distribution, it is morphine circulates in the plasma, partly protein-bound and partly in free form. Highest concentrations in the organs like brain, lungs, liver, kidneys, and spleen, more than that of in plasma. So it crosses less through the blood-brain barrier and more often through placental barrier, causing fetal depression, fetal respiratory depression. So glucuronidation of the fetus is also slow. So the long half-life and more toxicity and predominantly more of respiratory depressant effect. And it is also secreted in the milk. So we need to be very careful. Then metabolized by the liver and kidney. So it gets converted into morphine 6-glucuronide, which is more potent, and morphine 3-glucuronide, which is having neuroexcitatory property, producing convulsions in the patient. Then deconjugated and hydrolyzed, that is another pathway, and reabsorbed, undergoing intrahepatic circulation. And it is converted to normorphine by demethylation, which is, of course, a minor pathway. And half-life is, of course, 2 to 3 hours, whereas that of the active metabolite glucuronide is very long half-life. Then excretion through renal, main route is renal, and the rest of the minor pathway is biliary excretion. Then toxicity of opioids. So in therapeutic doses, generally, whenever you administer therapeutic doses of opioids, it produces general manifestations, toxic manifestations like nausea, vomiting, dysphoria, mental clouding, lethargy, vertigo, all these kinds of things. And of course, tremors and delirium, respiratory depression. So what are all the pharmacological, pharmacodynamic actions that we have already discussed in the first session? The same extension. So you can write down all the things here. Blurring, apart from that, blurring of vision, and then urinary retention, of course, in elderly male and who are more prone for BPH. Then hypotension. Then intolerance, that is allergic skin rash, pruritus, and contact dermatitis. And most commonly it is because of histamine liberation, but it could also be because of a central mechanism, that is proprioceptor neurons in the spinal cord, that is the stimulation of these neurons, because of which also intolerant manifestations also can result. And anaphylactic reactions with hypotension can also may manifest. And then hypotension, bronchospasm, allergic reactions, and then this, because of the histamine release, the bronchospasm may release, result in case of opioid administration. So fentanyl can be used safely in asthmatics. That is causing it will not cause bronchospasm. Then CNS and respiratory depression. So respiratory depression at higher doses and in infants and elderly, even in small doses also it happens. then sedation, meiosis, constipation, vomiting. Then constipation more dangerous in old people because it may precipitate intestinal obstruction and also cause abdominal distension and increase biliary pressure. Then hypotension because of vasodilatation. Then urinary retention most often is seen with old people, men especially, with suffering from BPH. Then on the fetus, so it is crossing the placental barrier, so it has the tendency to produce fetal respiratory depression. So, but this can be reversed by administering naloxone 10 micrograms per kg body weight injected directly into the umbilical cord. That is the drug of choice and made preferable route of administration. Apart from that, it can be administered through either IV or IM, and rarely through subcutaneous route of administration also. Then in toxic doses, it results in acute morphine poisoning. So we'll see what it is. So it can be, this poisoning can result from either clinical overdosage or accidental overingestion by an addict or from suicidal or homicidal intention. So lethal dose is an average, that is 50 to 250 milligrams. Then signs and symptoms, all the things that whatever we have discussed in the pharmacodynamics, you can write down all the things. Respiratory depression, pinpoint pupils, cyanosis, reduced body temperature, decreased urinary output, hypotension, shock, coma, convulsions in infants, and death is usually due to respiratory depression. This is the predominant cause of death. Then apart from that, in the victimized person, you can see the history of drug abuse and presence of needle marks also. Then treatment, proper of acute morphine poisoning. So maintain the patient's vitals, so ABC, patent airway, and prevent aspiration of respirator gastric content, and supportive measures like maintenance of blood pressure by IV fluids or vasoconstriction administration also if required. And then respiratory support, that is positive pressure, ventilation. Then gastric lavage, this is very, very important. So emetics, anyway, they're not going to be useful here in case of poisoning. Then gastric lavage is done with potassium permanganate to remove unabsorbed drug that coming through enterohepatic circulation. So it is done. Whether the morphine is taken through oral route or parenteral administration, so you can go for gastric lavage because the potassium permanganate is basic in nature. So it will enter into the stomach. In acidic pH, it gets ionized in acidic pH and then just persists there. So morphine, when the concentration in the blood is so much, so it diffuses into the acidic environment of the stomach and it combines with the potassium permanganate and it gets excreted. So the morphine must be removed while in stomach only before it enters into the intestine, because once it enters into the intestine, because of the alkaline pH, it may remain unionized also. So then, if a toxic dose of morphine has been ingested, even late gastric lavage is justified because the spasmogenic action of morphine frequently delays its absorption. That is the That is the beneficial point here in case of morphine poisoning. Then opioid antagonist administration, we need to give some antidote, right? Then naloxone and nalorphone are specific antagonists. So naloxone is preferred because it is pure antagonist, whereas nalorphine is having both the agonistic and antagonistic actions also. So nalorphine generally is not preferred, but it is preferred in case of poisoning due to mu receptor agonist. Naloxone to be given 0.4 to 0.8 milligrams IV, repeated every 5 minutes. And then again, 1 to 3 hours until the total morphine is getting like cleared out of the body. Why to give repeated administration? Because of short action of naloxone. Then attention is being directed to make naloxone via IM and intranasal routes also. Then nalorphine is not a pure antagonist. So we have discussed this point. But if naloxone is not available, nalorphine can be administered and is life-saving in case of morphine poisoning and poisoning due to other opioids and mu receptor agonists. That's what we discussed just now, such as pethidine poisoning, fentanyl, all these things. but not satisfactory in poisoning with agonists, antagonists, mixed agonists and antagonists. Then, so this is the poisoning management, acute morphine poisoning management, step by step, like ABC and supportive management, and then acute, what is the antidote that we have to select between the two, and then what is the route of administration and the dose, what we have to give. And the symptoms, of course, we have discussed. Then coming to the precautions in opioid poisoning management, in morphine or opioid addicts or dependents, what you should do. Suppose if you are going to deal the case with the antagonist, there will be like overshoot phenomenon or withdrawal phenomenon may result, giving rise to hypertension, tachycardia, cardiac arrhythmias, all these things. So precipitation of withdrawal syndrome can be minimized by giving naloxone 0.4 mg slow IV, watching for regaining of consciousness and recovery of respiratory depression. Then, second one, poisoning with the long-acting opioids are due to short action of naloxone. Naloxone, of course, is a short-acting that we already know. Suppose if the poisoning is because of long-acting opioids, what should we do? So, the antidote, whatever we are giving, because the poison itself is very long-acting, so the antidote or antagonist, whatever we administer, should be given of an adequate duration of time. In case of long-acting opioids such as methadone and buprenorphine. So in such case of poisonings. Okay. So in such cases, the better modality of treatment is not only naloxone, which produces prompt action, it has to be combined along with the naltrexone, which maintains the action. So this is the modality of treatment for long-acting opioid poisoning. Then poisoning due to mixed agonist and antagonist like that of pentazocine. So drug of choice is only naloxone or other pure antagonist. So nalofen can never be used. And nalmefene, of course, long-acting can be given by IV route. Then toxicity on prolonged use. So for a long period of administration, like in case of chronic cancer therapy, so the opioid usage may land upon intolerance and dependence. So repeated administration of morphine at short intervals results in decreased efficacy of the drug molecule. So tolerance to morphine is attributed primarily to the ability of the cells. So withstanding the large doses, and it could be a pharmacodynamic or pharmacokinetic. I'm not going into the details because we have already discussed in general pharmacology. Then, so what is this tolerance? So we have discussed under the pharmacodynamic effects. So tolerance to so-and-so pharmacodynamic effects, and tolerance is not seen with meiosis and constipation. And it is also not seen with convulsant action and does not develop to antagonistic actions of pure or mixed agonist and antagonist. And apart from that, cross-tolerance is also seen with other opioid analgesics and other CNS depressants like barbiturates and alcohols. Then opioid rotation. So you may get like a short note 3 marks question or even in Viva OC, and it is very important for postgraduate students. So what is this opioid rotation? So whenever there is tolerance to analgesic action, so one analgesic, opioid analgesics that you have put the patient on, the efficacy is going down because of tolerance. So you need to pick up some other molecule. And cross-tolerance is also there with other opioid analgesics. So what do? You rotate the molecules. You don't keep the patient on single opioid analgesics for a long period of time because of the risk of tolerance. So you constantly change the molecules. Opioid, that is what is known as opioid rotation. Morphine to methadone, methadone to fentanyl. What is the advantage? It improves the analgesic effect at reduced dosage. So that is opioid rotation. And alternatively, opioids can be combined with non-opioid analgesics when there is a risk of tolerance for analgesic property. So you can combine opioids with the non-opioid analgesics or even with ketamine, that is an NMDA receptor antagonist, to prevent the tolerance or reverse the tolerance. So that is tolerance. Then physical dependence. So morphine has high abuse liability. Physical dependence of severe type is produced, and withdrawal syndrome is also also can be seen. Then what is the mechanism of this addiction or dependence? Chronic use of morphine and other similar opioid drugs such as pethidine, heroin, all these. So whenever you administer for a long period of time, neuroadaptation occurs because of reduced noradrenergic activity. Okay. So rebound increase in noradrenergic activity on sudden withdrawal of morphine leading to tachycardia, hypertension, all these can be counted as withdrawal effects. And the addiction or dependence is because of decreased noradrenergic activity. Withdrawal is due to rebound increase in noradrenergic activity. So in order to prevent morphine dependence, it should not be prescribed for chronic pain for a long period of time. So that is not preferable. Then because of the risk of tolerance and dependence, both the factors as well. Then dependence on morphine and morphine light drugs results mainly from euphoriant effects. So the kick or thrill effect the patient person experiences. So because of which it has become the drug of abuse. And then morphine addicts are usually malnourished and debilitated, even though they do not suffer from motor incoordination and are capable of performing complex motor and intellectual tasks. Their productivity and utility to the society usually suffer because of this. And another risk is injection abscesses because they self-inject themselves the opioid derivatives, especially in case of tetanus, AIDS, serum hepatitis. That is, these infections are also high among the addicts because of the injections and mixing, free mingling. Then treatment of morphine dependence. So similar to that of alcohol or barbiturate dependence. So we don't get much of a good outcome. High relapse rate is also there. So the moment you want to withdraw the molecule, so withdrawal phenomenon will manifest. So you need to substitute with another less potent opioid analgesics. Then only you can remove the molecule totally. So then opioid like morphine has to be replaced with the methadone or substituted with the methadone, which has longer duration of action than morphine. So 1 milligram of methadone will substitute for 4 milligrams of morphine. So then after the patient gets stabilized, then you have to slowly switch over the methadone molecule also from the patient. And if at all there are opioid withdrawal symptoms that can be countered with the usage of chlorpromazine, propranolol, and clonidine, which counter the noradrenergic overactivity. So this is the reason why we use these molecules. Then acute withdrawal syndrome. So poisoning, tolerance, dependence, withdrawal syndrome. So this is about toxicity apart from the routine toxic manifestations. So symptoms of acute withdrawal syndrome are lacrimation, rhinorrhea, anning, we discussed already this, pyloerection, diarrhea, nausea, coughing, midriasis, sweating, etc. So withdrawal is due to excessive noradrenergic activity. So we are going to use clonidine molecule, which is like, it suppresses the abrupt increase in noradrenergic activity on discontinuation of opioids due to central alpha-2-agonistic action. So that is the main mechanism of action. Then lofexidine is also preferred over clonidine because hypotension is less likely with this molecule. Okay. Then role of opioid antagonists in morphine addiction. Opioid antagonists are used for prevention of addiction when a patient is totally de-addicted. So naltrexone is orally effective and even transdermal patches are also available. So what you should do to avoid the withdrawal manifestations, prompt detoxification of opioid addict has to be done under general anesthesia. So the patient may not experience the withdrawal manifestations. Then after the patient recovers, it can be switched over to the oral therapy, oral opioid antagonist, such as naltrexone can be administered to prevent further pleasurable and euphoriant effect and the addiction. So this is how we are going to manage the case. Then adverse effects with acute use and chronic use. So respiratory depression, nausea, vomiting, pruritus, urticaria, all these things. And increased growth hormone secretion, all hormonal immune modulator tolerance, dependence, abuse, hyperalgesia, of course, and impairment while driving for chronic use. Then therapeutic uses. So in connection to the pharmacodynamic effects, toxicity, therapeutic uses, all are interrelated. Analgesic. So used for relief of moderate to severe deep-seated visceral pain. We discussed in the preliminary slides. The introduction. With MI, renal colic, traumatic, post-operative and cancer pain. Then severe burns, pulmonary embolism, all acute pains, fractures of long bones, acute pericarditis, spontaneous pneumothorax. So acute cases of pain, we can go for opioids as analgesics. And apart from that, frightening situations, it allays the anxiety. So sedative and anxiolytic action also can be used for this purpose. But whenever there is head injury, it is absolutely contraindicated. Apart from that, controlled release morphine or oxycodone tablets are available for chronic cancer pain. Then rectal suppositories of morphine and hydromorphone when oral and parenteral routes are not feasible. And other routes of administration for post-operative pain is IM or subcutaneous, but subcutaneous route is not preferable when patient is landing upon in shock because absorption is decreased in such cases. Then intra-articular injection for knee joint arthritis, then epidural morphine to produce long-lasting analgesia following thoracic and upper abdominal surgery. There are all the various routes of administration of opioids. This is a very, very important question. Then codeine or dextropropoxifen can be combined with NSAIDs to give rise to give a supra-additive effect for headaches and neuralgias. Then neuropathic pain, of course, does not respond or responds very less to the opioid analgesics. Then for milder pains like toothache, headache, arthralgia, all these things, aspirin-like analgesics are preferred. And if it is not getting a fruitful result, then mild opioid analgesic also can be combined with opioid, NSAIDs, or can be given even alone also. Then not all types of pains respond to opioids. That is like deafferentiation pain, which is resistant. Then other routes of administration are buccal transmucosal route, that is fentanyl citrate lozenge or lollipop mounted on a stick. So that can be like given for episodes of breakthrough pain. Then butorphanol nasal formulations are available for intranasal administration to avoid the first-pass metabolism, high first-pass metabolism of the opioid derivatives. Then, so it can be given through oral, rectal, subcutaneous, IM, IV, and transdermal, except sublingual and intrathecal cannot be given for all indications. They can be given, not absolutely contraindicated, but not all situations. Transdermal patch, that is for patients with chronic pain. So fentanyl patch, that is less risk of respiratory depression this molecule is having. So fentanyl patch, even the toxic manifestations are not that much. Then buprenorphine patch, that is transdermal delivery. Again, it is a mixed agonist and antagonist. Then morphine in MI. Acute MI, the first step that you have to give to get the patient relieved of the pain and anxiety is MI, that is morphine. That is a life-saving molecule. It relieves the pain as well as reduces preload and pulmonary edema due to vasodilation. So it has to be given. The route of administration is slow IV or IM or subcutaneous route, unless the patient is landing upon it. Shock. Then dose 5 to 10 mg slow IV, IM or subcutaneous 10 to 15, epidural or intrathecal 2 to 4 mg, oral is 10 to 50 mg. The renal and biliary colic. So the problem there is the spasm of the smooth muscle. That is a pathology. It is giving rise to acute agonizing pain to the patient. So the goal of therapy is, first is agonizing pain has to be relieved to the patient. And the second one is spasm of the smooth muscle has to be relaxed. So for that, we need to combine both morphine and atropine to give a complete recovery to the patient, both for renal and biliary colic. Then obstetric labor. So opioid analgesics are often prescribed. But the thing is that they cross the placental barrier, producing neonatal respiratory depression. So for that, we have to pick up the molecules who those have the less respiratory depression tendency. It is like meperidine or fentanyl, and even pethidine also can be preferred. Then chronic cancer pain. So we need to administer the opioids for analgesic property for a long period of time. So continuous release formulations are preferred. Substituting oral methadone for morphine or opioid rotation also can be done with various potent analgesics. Then transdermal fentanyl for, of course, like 12 long hours, uniform blood levels can be maintained and that can be changed every 3 days. Then buprenorphine, which is the combination of mixed agonist and antagonistic, that also can be given as transdermal patch. Then, in addition, stimulant drugs such as amphetamines can enhance the analgesic actions of opioids. So they also can be combined with opioid administration. And another thing is infusion pump administration, so that our opioids can be infused for a long period of time. Then patient control analgesia, new alternative method of self-administration. Patient can himself or herself change the dosage. So how much to take and how often to take, depending on the pain intensity. So it is IV administration, of course, pump will be, the control will be by the patient. That is the main advantage. So usually fentanyl molecule is used, which is having less risk of toxicity. So you can see here. So the patient is able to modulate continuous infusion. Then acute left ventricular failure, morphine IV is the best option. So the main mechanism of action here is it reduces the preload and afterload as well. Then it also is preferred molecule for the pulmonary edema management along with that. Then puff suppressant, codeine is most commonly used in sub-analgesic doses for dry irritating cough. Then in anesthetic practice, for pre-anesthetic medication, pethidine is the best molecule that is used. And of course, fentanyl is used for neuroleptic analgesia, neuroleptic anesthesia, and balanced anesthesia. Then it is used through IV or epidural administration for coronary bypass grafting, because it has no cardiovascular toxicity. So this is a very safe molecule in bronchial asthma and cardiovascular dangers also. Then intrathecal or epidural injection of morphine or fentanyl. So that is also preferred for segmental anesthesia. Then less risk of respiratory depression. Then to control diarrhea, because the morphine and opioid molecules in general have a constipating tendency, the codeine molecule can be used in the management of non-infectious acute diarrhea. Apart from that, loperamide and diphenoxylate also can be used. Then sedation and sleep, of course, in case of threatened abortion, it can be used as a sedative. And morphine has been used routinely for sedating patients with internal bleeding, but diazepam is a safer molecule when compared to morphine because not much toxicity. Then reducing shivering, meperidine can be used. It blocks shivering mainly through action on alpha 2 adrenoceptor. Then non-analgesic uses of opioids, that is antidiarrheal, diphenoxylate, and loperamide. It is very, very important 3 marks question for UGs. Then central puff suppressants, codeine and dextromethorphan, emetic apomorphine. In acute LVU, that is morphine. Then preparations and dosages. We have controlled release tablets as morphine sulfate, then morphine solution. Dose in adults is 10 to 30 mg with terminal cancer, that is up to 200 mg we can go for. But it is like less efficacious because high first pass metabolism is there. Then morphine hydrochloride or sulfate injection. So PGS will be routinely asked for any molecule, in fact. So what is the salt available form of the salt? So morphine is available as a salt, that is morphine hydrochloride or sulfate injection. Then subcutaneous or IM 10 to 20 mg, IV 2.5 to 5 mg. For infusion, 10 mg for first hour and then 10 mg over next 4 hours. IV infusion by epidural and intrathecal administration. Then coming to the precautions and contraindications. Respiratory disease or bronchial asthma. Morphine causes respiratory depression, that we know for sure. So it can precipitate an attack of bronchial asthma by its histamine release. So less risky molecule that can be given is fentanyl molecule. And because of this risk, morphine should also be avoided in other conditions where poor respiratory reserve is there. That is emphysema, kyphoscoliosis, COPD, pulmonary fibrosis, CAR pulmonary, all these cases, because to avoid the respiratory failure and death of the patient. And apart from that, opioids decrease ciliary activity. And there is cough depression is also there. Bronchospasm is also there. And depression of respiration is there. So it has to be very, very carefully used. So almost absolute contraindication of morphine molecule in case of bronchial asthma. Deaths have been reported in patients with COPD following therapeutic doses of morphine itself. Is it? Then morphine accentuates sleep apnea, hypoxic brain damage can occur. So the same points. Then undiagnosed acute abdomen. So it causes spasm of smooth muscles and may aggravate certain conditions, that is diverticulitis, biliary colic, pancreatitis, inflamed appendix. It may get ruptured. So because undiagnosed acute abdomen, so you don't know the reason. What is the reason for acute abdomen? In that cases, morphine can mask the symptoms. So better not to administer morphine in such conditions. So after the diagnosis is established, then you can go for like pentazocine, buprenorphine. So because the ALS is likely to aggravate biliary spasm. Head injury, absolute contraindication because it increases the CSF pressure due to carbon dioxide retention and stimulates the spinal cord, produces respiratory depression, so mental clouding, miasis, all these things put together. Head injury or morphine toxicity or something else, we can't find out. So absolute contraindication. And first predominant reason is increasing in CSF pressure. Then pharmacokinetic alteration in case of neonates and elderly people. So morphine and betadine may cause respiratory depression. So treatment is with naloxone in such cases. Then in elderly also, it has to be given under care. That is like a special precaution because lower doses of morphine is required for analgesic action. And in case of BPH, urinary retention, and respiratory depression is more with elderly people. Then hepatic and renal disease, dose has to be reduced because of risk of cumulative toxicity. Then shock, because it may produce hypotension, it is to be contraindicated. Use during pregnancy, because it may cross the placental barrier, so it is risky to the fetus or baby. So, and the baby, if the pregnant lady is on opioids, though the baby may land upon in withdrawal symptoms also in early postpartum period. Then endocrine disorders, patients with Addison's disease or hypothyroidism or myxedema exhibit prolonged exaggerated response to opioids and thus should be avoided because of the basal metabolism is reduced. Then same thing here. Then mentally abnormal person, they're more likely to become morphine addict. Then use a pure agonist with weak partial agonist. When a weak partial agonist such as pentazocine is given to a patient receiving full agonist, so risk of diminishing analgesia and also withdrawal phenomenon. So we have to be very careful. So we should not combine with pure agonist with partial agonist. Then, so overall contraindications of morphine, 5-H and 3-V, just try to remember that. 5-H, what are they? Hypotension, hepatic damage, BPH, that is hypertrophy of prostate, head injury, hypothyroidism. These are 5-H. And what are 3-V? Bronchial asthma, biliary colic, and another B is babies or infants. Okay. Then the last one, that is drug interactions. CNS represents alcohol, phenothiazines, MAVA inhibitors, tricyclic antidepressants. They all enhance the side and sedative effects of morphine and increase the respiratory depression. And phenothiazines cause potentiation of analgesic action, but also potentiate hypotension and respiratory depression. Antidepressants potentiate analgesia. Antihistaminics enhance analgesia. Then amphetamines increase the analgesic effect. Opioids, mainly morphine, reduce the absorption of certain drugs because it delays gastric emptying and reduces gut motility. And epidural administration of opioids. So use of corticosteroids should be stopped 2 weeks prior to the insertion of the catheter to prevent chances of infection, because immunosuppressive action will be there with corticosteroid administration. So there has to be gap further. Any opioid partial agonist should not be given to the patients. Any opioid partial agonist should not be given to the patients receiving pure opioid agonist. So that's what we discussed in the earlier slide. Risk of precipitating severe withdrawal phenomena, decreasing analgesia. So this is all about the opioid analgesics and antagonists and the drugs proper. I'll be dealing it with all those drugs in a short session, that is in a third session. So thank you. Thank you all for your patient listening. So please go through the lecture and try to present it nicely in your second internal assessment examination. Thank you. Thank you all.